you empower the two of us to make those decisions by you not wanting to do it, and by, you know, us wanting to do it, and, you know, getting a kick out of doing it, you know? I enjoy doing it.
Somebody will, you know, be pissed at the way someone else is playing and say, fine, you do it, fuck it, I'm out of here, and just leave. What was the question again?
We are dealing with this person who's leaving, and now what are we going to do? I mean...
We've got nowhere else to go. And I mean, we joke around about that, but it's the fucking truth. Like, nobody put up with any of our frickin' attitude.
My real name is Jon Morley. I'm the drummer in Katheter.
My name is Kevin Burns. I'm the rhythm guitar player for Katheter.
I'm Marty Hitzeman. I play lead guitar for Katheter, not the rhythm guitar. That guy's a wuss.
Well, my name's Phil Bluss. Play the bass in this band called Katheter.
I will tell you about Zach Hubeck. I'm Zach. I'm 25.
And have been with the band since the beginning.
Been playing drums for about 20 years.
I have been with the band about 10 months. I'm the hired gun of the band. Hired gun of the band.
We've had some problems with wussy rhythm guitar players, but I play lead nonetheless.
I played with Marty for a while in a band called Shattered Glass.
I am the lead singer, and yeah, that's about it.
I feel I bring a sense of youthful vibrance.
Drummers, my favorite drummers. When I was a kid, it was Peter Criss.
My biggest musical influence would have to be probably Jimmy Page, or yeah, the band Led Zeppelin, Jimmy Page. It's the reason I started playing guitar.
It would probably be someone like, and I wish I could play like him, but like a Stevie Ray Vaughan.
I mean, I grew up as a kid in the 70s and 80s, and so the big bands that, you know, excited me were bands like Queen and Kiss.
But guys like that, Hendrix, you know, Fogerty.
Then Neil Peart, of course, John Bonham.
My brother turned me on to physical graffiti in Kashmir, and I just knew I had to play at that point.
Pearl Jam was definitely a musical influence when I was growing up. I always used to sing Eddie Vedder tunes in the car.
You know, actually, Gary Richrath from REO.
Beatles are great. Led Zeppelin I used to listen to all the time. I used to listen to all the oldies.
The bands throughout the 90s, like Green Day, Blink-182, Nirvana, and whoever, anybody that was being obnoxious musically, probably had some influence on Katheter sound.
I like the new Carter Beauford from... what the hell is that band he plays in? With that guy that sings hee-haw, ha ha.
Some of the guys from the hair bands in the 80s.
Lately, I can't even say that any of the current music is influencing me at all.
Wait, Dave Weckl.
Rex Ewing from Flickerstick, and Martin Hitzman from Katheter.
I've had maybe two formal lessons ever.
I knew Marty before I joined Katheter. Marty and I actually worked together.
Kevin Burns, he's a new guy. He came along after Brian.
You know, I play in a band, and I had seen Katheter play once before. And he said, you know, that we might be looking to, you know, add another guitar player because ours left.
Brian Weeder was one of the original Katheter players.
Kevin Burns replaced our old hanger-on named Brian Weeder.
A guy named Brian Weeder had to leave for whatever reason or another. I think it was work-related. To tell you the truth, I never really got the whole gist of it.
He got his hand caught in a garbage disposal, so he couldn't play with us anymore.
He provided us all with a home. He provided us with a place to play.
It's a nub. There's no hand. It's just a nub now.
I would say he's more responsible for the existence of Katheter than anyone else.
So they're big shoes to fill. I mean, you're coming in and filling a guy that was, you know, a founding member of a band that was there for, you know, a lot of the stuff, laid the groundwork.
He was having a hard time playing with the nub.
It was late September when we finally broke the news to him and decided to part company.
So I didn't really look like the typical guitar player replacement guy.
But we owe him a great debt of gratitude for all he's done for us.
Basically, this band's been around for, 3 years or something like that.
In that time, you know, we've written and rehearsed and recorded and performed our own material.
Jon Morley's on drums, sings backup. Kevin Burns on rhythm guitar. Marty Hitzeman, lead guitar and backup vocals. Phil Bluss, bass and backup vocals. And me, Zach Hubeck, lead vocals.
Goof rock. Comedic alternative, X-rated adult rock.
And you'll be hearing that, I guess, sometime in this experience.
Thank you, we're Katheter, and right now we're going to punish Kevin Burns.
A lot of times we say Phil is the real deal, whatever that means.
It's probably Marty.
Phil's the real deal, man.
I'll just say Marty because everybody else says it's me.
Everyone kind of brings their own thing to the band, but I don't think I'm ever the best musician in the band, and I'm gonna give Zach shit because singers aren't really musicians.
Phil is a good singer. He's a great bass player. He's a better guitar player than I am. He just won't admit it. He plays drums. He does it all. He's by far the best musician in this band.
I might be a little more versatile. And I can play different instruments, but I don't know, best musician. I can't really say I'm the best musician.
But as far as musicianship, I think Phil is probably the most talented.
I think I put more effort into music in a more rounded way than the others, because I do have you know, far-reaching interests in music, not beyond just playing in Katheter. The most creative individual in the bunch, I believe, is John.
Creating something from nothing, that falls to Marty and John.
I think I'm the most creative guy in the band. I mean, I think most ideas come out of me and...
Well, it could be Marty. Marty could be the most creative too.
You can't just have that one creative force because everything will sound the same, so everybody else contributing is really important. And Zach has really come a long way, man.
I love you, Shale, brother.
And it's weird, the three of them can almost... It's like twins. They can almost carry on an entire conversation without speaking.
I'd say Morley is the most creative. He comes up with crazy lyrics. He comes up with music and kind of says, hey, this sounds good, that sounds good.
Zach and John are in the unfortunate position of being, you know, the singer and the drummer, who typically don't get credit for being creative. I mean...
Sometimes Phil seems to be pretty creative, yeah. Maybe Phil's the most creative. What the hell's that noise?
As far as the most creative that I've experienced, probably Marty and to some extent Phil, just given the number of things that Phil, I know, has come up with and wrote.
I think it's me.
The least talent. Boy, how many times has Kevin's name come up?
I'd probably say Burns, because...
He sucks, but he's cool, man, and he's gay, so, you know, we're an equal opportunity employer.
I am by far the least talented of any of the five in this band.
I don't think I could respond to the question.
I'm also the least coordinated.
How do you define least talented of the group?
Burns, no offense.
Maybe Zach is the least talented.
Is Kevin, because he's not essential for us?
And besides, Burns brings the management end of things, like I said before, so everybody's got their strong points.
We existed before him, and if he dropped out or if he quit, we would be able to carry on without him.
Maybe Phil is. Marty could be. Yeah, it's hard to say.
Burns can play, though. He just plays different stuff.
I think we all have a great deal of talent, and that's about all I have to say about that. I don't know.
Well, you could look at him. He wears that white Elvis belt, and he's got the curly blonde hair. And some might say he's gay. I don't know. I don't know if he is or not.
Kevin Burns is not, has not ever been, and never will be gay.
He's kind of latent and homosexual, but I'm just waiting for him to come out the closet. He'll get there, though. Cute guy. Very cute man.
Not that there's anything wrong with that. If you're marching to that drummer, right on. God bless you. Go to town, brother. Get yours.
Gay? No. Insecure and likes to be liked? Yes. But who doesn't like to be liked? We all like to be liked.
I have two older brothers at home, and every time I'm out with those guys, they introduce me as the gay brother.
It's possible. He might be latent. He's one of those really right-wing Republican types.
I walk to the beat of a little different drummer than most of the guys do. I dress a little bit differently. I dress a little and act a little bit more flamboyantly.
And, you know, wears real neat clothes and primps his curly hair all the time. But I don't know if that means you're gay or not. I don't know.
I think there's some envy, you know, and some in a more of a reminiscent way.
Kevin's not gay. At least he told me that in a shower the other night.
If this is viewed by any young single women, you can take that to heart. And
Kevin might be gay.
I've been called a pretty boy my whole life. These guys call me
insecure,
blatant and homosexual,
homophobic,
gay.
He's gay.
You're gay. Come out of the closet, buddy. We'll still love you. It's all right.
Every perk you've ever heard about coming with being in the band is absolutely true, I will say.
The women.
We get all the old fat chicks you can handle, man.
I'd definitely say camaraderie.
I mean, you know, anybody can nail a cute, hot-looking college student. They're all drunk anyway.
They just run screaming for me, I don't know.
When times are sweet, and I think that's a good perk, it's always fun to play a show with these guys, and when we do a kick-ass job at the end, it's like, look what we've done.
But you know, you nail like a mid-aged housewife, come on, that's the shit.
You know, you get a few free drinks along the way.
It's only been recently that I've got to learn the wonders of being in a band. I'm not sure I've capitalized on it as I should, but I have seen more attention paid to me after having been in a band and been on stage than I have previously.
I haven't found a single perk to playing in any band ever.
My best moment with Katheter had to have been a couple weeks ago at Gunther Murphy's.
No, without a doubt, the best moments have been on stage when we were really cooking. And I think we've, in these last two gigs we've done, we probably played better than we had in quite a while.
The best moment with Katheter, it would probably be when I'm at home.
I'd say the perk is definitely camaraderie.
When I'm furthest away from Katheter.
The place we played at Gunther Murphy's, we were cooking there. There was all this tension because the sound man was, you know, giving us shit. And
we just fucking tore it up and rocked, I think. I think the band was playing good together. We were rocking.
Yeah, it was a really tight gig, a lot of fun.
Then Coyle's Tippling House, too, was good. We played well. We kind of, like, it was good. Like, we blew these other bands off the stage.
I ended up playing, you know, half of a couple songs down on my knees, just really getting into the music.
We had fun. And that's what it's about, is having fun and rocking the fans, all eight of them.
Caught a lot of shit about playing on my knees, you know, I'm a little, little showboating, but you know, I can't do the dancing and the rhythm that Zach, Phil, and Marty could do. So,
you know, we did really well, and then another band went up there and stunk the place up. Those were good moments. All our friends came out. And we've had that, you know, we've been lucky enough to have a couple moments like that before.
For the record, I hit my fiance in the head.
Katheter's debut CD is called Soapy Orifice. It was tentatively called Soapy Orifice, but it stuck.
If it ever be, you know, if we had to come up with a legitimate title, we might rethink that.
Soapy Orifice, Orifice, however you want to say it.
To my knowledge, our first full CD.
It's basically a 12-song thing, and it's ready to press in a way.
God, the Katheter CD took quite a while to make.
We started that thing 3 or 4 times just due to our inability to actually record things properly.
Can't really tell you much about it, except it's a project that's been worked on for the last 47 years.
The making of that CD was kind of similar to having a catheter.
I'm going to say we made 3 big energy thrusts at it.
I've had an angiogram before, and I think that was more pleasurable because I got some Demerol.
Probably Zach and I took the longest to do our parts, the vocals and the rhythm guitar.
It's been worked on forever. It's been very painful to make.
Because at that point I still didn't know all the songs.
It's been through several re-records, rewrites, masters, re-everything.
You know, a lot of screwing up, a lot of having to start over and going, you know, fuck, you know, and...
We don't know what we're going to do with it at this point. It might just be a promotional, you know, item.
I'd say Soapy Orifice is a compilation of a lot of guys with sick minds putting stuff down on paper and writing some music.
But it's some good shit.
We've got song titles like Whipped Cream Slut, Feeling Up Mrs. Butterworth. Couple serious tunes in there, but that's definitely a minority.
We try to go for the vulgar. It's just what comes naturally for us.
The majority is some smutty, silly, goofy stuff. Katheter.
But as a whole, I think it turned out okay. Turned out pretty good.
You know, had I had my way, it would be a much different sounding style of music, and we would not sound anything like we sound now, I believe.
Look what we've done. And I view Soapy Orifice the same way. It's like, look what we've created. This is a beautiful thing.
Feeling out, Mrs. Butterworth.
have no leadership. The band goes in 10 different directions all the time.
I don't think you ever really have, in a band like Katheter, I don't think you ever really have a clear-cut leader.
I would have to probably say that's the biggest problem with this band, is nobody's really taking the lead on anything.
I would say there is no leader in this band.
I think we all have our moments of leadership as far as contributions. Like Morley, he's a great mixer.
When it comes to a lot of the writing of the stuff, you know, Phil, John, Zach, Marty are leading the band.
Everyone takes a certain amount of leadership at times, and it does tend to create the too many cooks phenomenon.
Marty does a good job on the website, and Phil just comes and kicks ass playing his instrument.
The major leaders are Marty and John.
Marty and I go in two different directions.
And Zach does a lot of the footwork.
I like putting together posters and flyers and other BS like that.
There's a lot of leader personalities in this band. It's a power struggle on occasions.
Kevin Burns likes to put together the press stuff. He likes booking the gigs.
When it comes to some of the more business-oriented things regarding bookings and promotions, regarding with building the identity of Katheter, I would say that at that time I'm leading the band.
One good thing has been Kevin Burns coming in and taking control of management and really working on things so that, like, we're a little more focused.
Comes right down to it, I don't think any one of us wants the full reins over the direction of the band.
Yeah, I do. I do. I guess I do like being in charge, but you have to take on the full responsibility of everything. That means possibly booking the gigs, and you got everybody's got it's a big responsibility to be in charge.
Common phrase heard, hey, whatever, man, it's your band.
I don't know, man, it's your fucking band.
There are definitely some strong personalities.
The conclusion you can draw is, like, being in any band is like a complete soap opera drama. You know, it's a marriage, it's a job, it's a vacation, all wrapped up in one.
It's like a marriage, you know, the sex is good, but the relationship is bad.
And it's all just complete disillusionment at the end.
Britney Spears is a goddess to Katheter.
Britney Spears, I think, has an influence on Katheter's libidos.
Britney Spears' special influence that she has on this band really comes from Phil.
The reason we keep images of Britney around is just to perk up the day, you know?
I think Britney has always been motivation for us. One of our songs is called Britney, and it's about a stalker who follows Britney around.
Our music is about Britney Spears. It's all for her. Every note.
Frankly, I'm not a fan. I think she's kind of a slut.
I mean, she sucks my ass as a musician, but she sure is fucking pretty to look at, man.
She looks like she's got, you know, downs or something to me.
She's just a delicious little slut, and, you know, she just brightens our day.
But she's the epitome of a gorgeous pop star person type thing.
Except frankly, if she fell off the face of the earth tomorrow and stopped making music, I wouldn't shed a tear.
If we had more luscious babes to post on the walls, we'd put them up.
She's a good motivator. Gwen Stefani as well. Whew! Beautiful.
Nothing more than, you know, a little snap in the trousers. You know, that's all she's good for.
Myself. Speculation, it's unruly. I can't stop because you're
The Zach $20 situation. Wow. That's one where I ate a shitload of crow.
That was, it was kind of funny. It was unique. It was stupid.
Basically, we played a gig at Gunther Murphy's.
Zach let four folks in on a guest list.
It's kind of a long story.
We had all decided that we didn't have a guest list beforehand for the very reason that, you know, no one's wives, you know, girlfriends otherwise get in for free.
Zach had let some people in without telling the rest of the band, put them on a guest list without telling us, and Morley freaked out. I mean,
Zach, Shale used to get in collecting the money, and he'd come to us and he'd go,
all right, fellas.
Fellas, here's your $12. Yeah. I'm like, I spent more than that in beer tonight.
And the gentleman asked me, hey, who gets the money? I said, what the heck? I'm standing right here. That's fine. I'll distribute it amongst the boys.
Zach felt it was okay to let some folks in, and I didn't have a problem with that.
Oh, yeah. This is the actual envelope.
Don't worry about it. It's on us. You guys did a kick-ass job. Here you go. Here's the money.
Guess $25 not made. However, was made. Meaning they gave us the 25 because we're such a damn good band.
I leave early, and Burns and Morley get to talking.
Kevin had an issue with Zach collecting the money, and I asked some questions about the guesting on the envelope.
My whole issue with the thing was it should have been prepared beforehand, and I discussed this with Zach. It should have been prepared beforehand so that I could tell the bar, and so we didn't look disorganized.
Phil, on the way home, kind of said, well, maybe Zach, you know, he didn't mean it. He, you know, maybe that didn't really happen. I don't know.
It didn't end, I mean, it ended up costing us money, but it didn't, kind of thing.
The truth is, it did happen. He guested four people. He didn't ask anybody about a guest list, and I got upset.
To me, I understood Morley's point. He had a good point. Zach didn't talk to us about it, but you know what? I was like, just get $20 from Zach and fucking leave it at that. But I think John, because of miscommunication, took it farther and attacked Zach's credibility.
So John leaves me a nasty gram.
This brutal email ripping into his integrity.
He says, what the F is this? You're taking cuts? That's not even your money, you jackass!
From what I understand, he had a discussion with Kevin that night telling him that, hey, look, I guested four people in. If it costs $20 for him, I'll take it out of my own cut, out of my own pocket, and put it in there.
He questioned my character that I would take money out of their mouths or their children's mouths, whatever they were going to use it for.
Well, Kevin never relayed that information to me. So Zach got pretty upset and said, hey, pal, I talked to Kevin about it. You should talk to him. I did talk to Kevin. Kevin said, oh, sorry, man. I forgot to tell you that part.
Morley,
so you were able to negotiate that whole thing to me.
Now sober, yeah.
Drunk.
No.
But you neglected to tell me about the $20 incident with Zach.
But it offended me. It pissed me off, and it didn't make my Friday at all.
I read that email. I'm like, I'm sorry.
Dude, man, why is he collecting the money? I don't understand.
That was my only issue.
I should be the I'm the conduit.
That was my only issue. Why are we having multiple people?
What is he, the big man?
Why are we having multiple
people? Is he the big money man?
John didn't trust me on that, which it hurt, man, really, because I consider John a true friend.
That was pretty painful, but, you know, I deserved it. I had it coming.
So I go out and I embarrass myself.
That's the Zach situation. The Morley situation involves,
Jon didn't want to go back and re-record his drums.
And there's some history there that I don't really know about, but I guess some of the shit was getting old and he was getting tired of it.
And we thought that Jon really didn't give his best performance on two of the songs.
Everybody was afraid to approach me on some drum licks that were played.
And we have felt, I'm going to say we, because you know who you are, we.
And they said, how are we going to deal with the Morley situation, which involved emails between Zach and Phil?
But anyway, we felt that Morley could do a better job. And in the past, when you confront Morley, he's a stubborn frickin' Czech like I am, and we're jackasses.
I don't know. He's been... guy's on the fucking rack. And I really wish he'd come off it, because he's like a big teddy bear, and I love him, man.
And it turned out that... they were coming up with some sort of plot.
Morley's a little on the short-tempered side, so we didn't know how to approach him and say, hey man, we think we should re-record this because it didn't turn out so hot.
Some plan to not have to confront me with it, to follow through with recording and wasting everybody's time, and then at the end I would see that the recording sounded like shit because of me.
I emailed Marty on a Monday morning saying, hey, how do we approach Morley about this? Should we tell him he, you know, played this, or should we just wait until we continue recording again and it'll stick out like dog balls because he's off here, he's off there.
However, they forgot to mention in their emails between each other that they were really drunk that night when they were trying to record their parts.
You know, he knows his shit and he's not going to back down on his opinion and he's not going to compromise his principle, which no one should have to.
And so... Marty replies back to my email, copying Jon intentionally, saying, no, Zach, you jackass, you pussy. I took care of the situation. Me and Morley are cool.
However, I have no problem re-recording my tracks if there's a good reason.
We weren't men about it. We should have just told him flat out. But I think Marty did betray me. He's good like that. He tries to do sneaky things here and there to make people blush.
If it just goes, well, you know, it'd be better if we record all together, well, that's no good. But if it's just, if there's a good reason, of course, I'm all for it.
And any time I do something bad, the Morley situation is brought up. It's a thorn in my side.
And then there was a Morley situation where John didn't want to be around for the recording, but he only wanted to do the mixing.
His and my relationship are built on giving each other as much shit as we possibly can, and I think it's unhealthy, but yet I think it is healthy.
My definition of the Morley situation has been sensed about the way he feels very put out by being in this band.
Maybe he's just unhappy, and that's sad. I mean, I don't want him to be unhappy. I want him to be happy, and I want him to stick around a Katheter.
He doesn't seem to want to be a part of it anymore. Like, he seems like we're wasting his time.
I mean, it can change, but he's got to allow it to. I'm ready to change it.
Having to go into the city to play gigs is a big hassle to him. And now he's decided to quit, so now we're all walking on eggshells around him.
Well, I'm leaving the band because I think I've outgrown Katheter.
John originally said that I was the reason he left the band, and I mean, I don't know if it's true. I think it's probably part true. He and I butt heads a lot, but...
I'd have difficulty playing with Marty in a band setting again, I think. Recording studio or whatever.
I said if it came down to me, I'd prefer that he stayed in the band.
He's also had blown-ups with every other member too, so
I don't have an issue with him leaving. I respect the decision he made, and I told John all this.
You know, I couldn't care less if we did any of the last three gigs.
Because frankly, I fear that if he leaves, our paths won't cross as much as they will, and that to me will be the biggest disappointment.
And you know what? Being in a band is a big pain in the ass. It's a lot of aggravation. And maybe he's just feels like he could do without it.
It's just this built up atom bomb of anger towards each other.
So the last of the Morley situation is John leaving and putting us in an awkward position.
Thank you.
I don't know exactly why John has decided to leave after all this time.
I don't think John is the only one leaving this band.
It could be something personal that he hasn't shared with us. And I mean, if it is, I guess I'd like to know.
The band is breaking up because John is initiating it, but it was inevitable, in my opinion.
But that's his own business. If he feels compelled to share it, that'd be great. But if it's just a point of, like, I've had enough of this, I understand that too.
John's leaving because of all the bullshit.
And there's too much arguing going on, there's too much fighting.
And we take all the little things and now it's just all built up in this huge ball of hatred. Bam!
This situation does go down that way, and John does decide that it's best for him to leave, and that's what he feels comfortable doing. And more power to him if he does, and I'll support it.
The fighting every third week and things like that, it just got out of hand, and it wasn't fun anymore. And it's like, why are we doing this if we're not having fun?
You know, he's come to the realization that he needs to spend more time on important issues and important things in his life.
It's usually about everything. It might be interruptions during the process.
There's a lot of crap in this band that happens. I mean,
I think we all bring our own set of personal problems that we don't all admit, and I think we take it out on each other a little too much.
And these last two gigs that we've played have been completely fun because it's been back to the music. It's been great.
But if he goes that route, you know, we can bring another drummer in.
Either I would have snapped and said, that's it, I can't take it anymore, which is probably bullshit because I got nothing better to do and I love these bastards and I love playing music with them.
John cannot be replaced if John leaves. That's like saying if your father dies, will your stepfather replace him?
I think we could replace him, but I really have no desire to do that.
I think a lot of us are leaving the band, both mentally and physically.
It's not gonna happen. No one's ever gonna replace John. However, you may bring someone else in to fill that role.
His particular contribution to the music is as essential as any.
I would hope Katheter would continue on without me.
It's like we have to either stay together as is or forget about it. It's over.
I cannot stress the importance enough of not chopping something off at the knees when it's just started taking off.
You can't just put another guy on there and have it sound the same.
I know Phil said before, if one of us leaves, it's over.
So no, I don't want to replace him and I don't want to carry on without him.
That's up to them.
But yes, definitely the band will continue. It'll be without John, but it won't be Katheter as it is right now.
If it lasts, that's cool. If it doesn't, you knew that going in, that it might not.
I hope John sincerely stays. I hope he does. I don't want him to leave.
I believe Saturday's gig is significant because it very possibly could be the end.
There's no fucking way that this Saturday night is ever going to be Katheter's last performance.
I think it will be Katheter's last performance because I think John is just too stubborn to, like, have a change of heart.
We fucking rock, and I think that we all need to focus on that and put our stupid differences aside. Just put them aside.
I mean, it's possible that, you know, we might do another gig because we had an offer. Like, we've had a couple offers to play again.
I think this is going to be the last Katheter gig.
But it could be the end. It could be the very last show. And if we do play again together, it'll be something else.
I encourage as many folks as I know to come and check it out for themselves and really see that this band can play up to and better than, I would say, 90 to 99% of the shit that's out there on the radio.
Nobody thinks like it's really the end, but it just may be the end.
Yeah, there's just a lot of things that don't sit right with me, so I'm busting out.
I would have stayed in this band till the day I died, till the very last drop of blood was gone. I mean it.
Hi.
And then that, do you have to make all that noise on my, what the hell?
I'd like to say that I may have the smallest penis in the band, but I think I got the biggest heart, man, and a lot of love and a lot of dedication to the music.
I sing in the shower when I'm lathering my pubic region.
I have a bigger ego than half of you guys fucking combined. But you'd never fucking know it.
And actually, that prompted Morley to tell me that I really sucked his ass. And he's got a big ass, so I must have really blown.
Zach Hubeck is our lead singer. He's a very statuesque, kind of curly Howard or curly fine figure.
Katheter was the most challenging on my sanity.
Marty said I suck again.
I am the only one in the band who's made money as a recording artist. I get royalties from BMI. The checks used to be bigger, but now they're averaging about $8 to $16 every quarter.
Drummer is Jon Morley. He's good. He thinks he's better than he is.
Hey man, when anybody else can get paid $8 or $16 a quarter, you come and talk to me.
When the ball starts to really roll, we step in front of it and stop it from rolling.
I really don't appreciate your tone.
I mean, I can play with my acoustic guitar at home, but when you start playing with yourself after a while, wait a minute.
Slippery orifice. I don't know anything about a slippery orifice.
Check out a Katheter show. I'm always happy to talk with fans, share a beer and a smoke with you.
Do we sing, but we do homoerotic.
Wreck your little art project. Okay.
Oh, I'd like to say hi to my son, Gavin. You rock, buddy.
We're the man of the woman!
We brought him on in November of 1990, oh boy, I'm in the 21st century now.
What was your next question there?
I don't want to sound like Marty and be like, Katheter rocks!
Then Zach sometimes has this ego thing that he's the star, and all he carries around is that one little microphone. The hell was that?
Maker's Mark is good.
I could be gay. Don't interrupt me.
I'm sorry. Are you finished?
Yeah.
You can't have a person without a spine. You can't have a band without a backbone either.
Do you have to look at me like that?
But hopefully along the way, you know, you have some good laughs and you make some music. And, you know, you invest part of your life into it.
Enough with the fucking camera!